Tried to say was the players get dependent.
Tell them you please go and play.
Mentioned was anything is possible if you need it
Many
bad
times
enough.
I don't sleep in the night also, just 4-5 hours.
Just take help of the experts because
the
can...
feedback the parents gave to the child.
Bhushan, I really congratulate.
It's great to have this these talks.
Yes,
between
the parent plays the most important role in a sportsman or players.
See,
or...
The belief that sports and academics are
Usain Bolt record, and if you look at these,
tell us about that toughest phase of your life.
But I got into comfort zone and
see every day there are so many.
One of the biggest problems for athletes who don't understand is that.
But my coach Ripa sir, who always motivated me,
there were other riders also, but I was not.
I want to kind of just focus.
Two point of view: what a kid likes and what the parent want them to do, right?
Hello everyone, welcome to Sport Champ Talk Show, a life journey of an athlete. I'm Bhushan Thakur, founder and editor in chief of Sport Champ, a sports education magazine. Our today's show is on Know Your Champion, and we have a very special guest with us who will be sharing his amazing journey, which will inspire and guide many. Now, let me introduce our today's guest, Mr. Abhijit Kunte, international master in 1997 and international grandmaster in 2000, became first grandmaster from Pune and second from Maharashtra and fourth from India, winner of Shiv Chhatrapati Award in 1998-99, member of the Indian team for 4 chess Olympiads, and participated in 3 chess World Cups, won bronze medal in Asian Individual Chess Championship and 7 Asian medals, won 2 Commonwealth medals, participated in many international championships and won numerous medals. 2-time national champion and 7 age group national titles. Also national record holder of winning national junior title 3 times in a row and currently working as a senior manager in Indian Oil Corporation of India. Welcome to the show, Abhijit, and thank you for accepting
my invitation.
Thank you, Bhushan. Your list is so big that I have to choose only the minimum numbers. Otherwise, the entire talk show can go on just introducing you. So, Abhijit, you must have seen some of the shows or about Sports Champ. What do you think about Sports Champ talk show, the initiative?
I think during this COVID time, we all got some time actually to, you know, explore all these ideas, because otherwise we are just running here and there doing our regular work, day-to-day challenges. But I think it was a good time to introspect us also, to, you know, go back to the time and really think about what has to be done and whatever were our ideas which we could not fulfill. I think
Correct.
It was a good time that actually we could give some time to it.
Correct. Now let's start with the first round, which is a Sport Champ challenge. I'll be asking you 5 very simple questions. So I hope you are ready with it.
So you didn't tell me the first, yes? So I'm not ready with the answers.
So my first question to you will be, any international chess player name which starts with G?
G, Gusinov.
Okay. Any food name which starts with H?
Halwa.
Okay. any song name which starts with P? P for Paris.
I think the music is, you know.
I can see in your bag the Karwa is kept. So you must.
Yes, but it's from my wife. So.
Okay.
I think I'll say so, pass.
Okay, pass. Any singer name which starts with L?
Lata Mangeshkar.
Okay. And the last one is, any actor name which starts with A?
Anupam Kher.
Okay. A big fan of Anupam Kher?
Yeah.
Okay. Abhijit, tell us about your childhood, like your beginning days. From where you came and how you got into chess. What was your entire workings at the beginning stage? when you are getting into sport?
So of course I got into chess by accident. I think many of you know the story that I was a big fan of cricket, and my sister was playing chess, Mrunalini, and when she was playing in one inter-school tournament, my coach Mr. Mohan Phadke saw her playing. That time very few women players were participating in chess. It was about 1984 story I'm telling. And so it was so obvious that sir thought that, you know, he can teach her and make her a very good player. He was full of confidence that she can play in nationals or internationals in coming 5 to 6 years. So he came to my house and he convinced my parents that they must put Mrunal into a chess class. Now in 84 chess. So he was just giving some excuse for not doing it, but so he was just insisting. So he said, so my parents said finally, okay, we will send her to the class. So she started going. When she went first day, she lost the game. So she said she is not going from the next day. So it was Saturday, and I still remember that I had a cricket match that day. So my mother said, no, you must accompany Mrunal for a chess class. So I said, no, I don't want to play chess. I want to play cricket. And then my mother almost forced me. So I went to the chess class crying. That's how I started playing chess.
Okay.
But sir and his wife, they were so nice that, you know, they realized that how I have come. And then it became so much familiar. Like I became like one of their family members. So that time the chess class was not a concept where you come for 1 hour, you have fixed timings. Of course, you have fixed timings. But like I used to go every day cycling in the morning, 6:37. So I will go to his house, play 3-4 games, and then I will come back. Instead of cycling, I will just play chess and come back. But that time it was not like now it is not a chess class time, why you have come. So it was completely different atmosphere that time.
Correct.
And what he said, he actually happened that my sister played in Russia in 1988, exactly after 4 years.
Correct. So, what inspired you that time? Like you went to the chess class crying, but what was that time when you thought, I think this is the area where I have to do something? How it came to you or how you got to
know? I think about it. It happened way long back, I think, when I started playing, it was for fun. And Mrunal was actually the more serious player, and she was already playing nationals and internationals.
Correct.
I was winning, that time there were only 2 age groups, under 16 and under 19. So when I started, I was only 8. So it was, the competition was very tough for an 8-year-old boy to play in under 16. But then they started the age groups under 12, under 14. So I won the first under 12 national championship, which happened in Chennai in 1988. And then I was winning my age group nationals. I was also playing the world championships kind of thing. I won the national sub juniors. Then I also got the medal in the Asian sub juniors, bronze medal. But still, chess was not so popular that time. I think one aspect was Anand became a grandmaster. So that gave a big push. Then second thing was I also got a job scholarship first from the Indian Oil in 1996, when I was already studying my final year of BCom. And that year I also won the National Senior Championship. So that's where I thought, okay, I can continue.
Abhijit, how was your parent support at that time? When you were starting playing or when you started at the beginning stage, what was your parent support? I think we just lost Abhijit due to some connectivity at his place. But we will get him soon. So here he's back. Abhijit, I guess there was a connectivity problem. I was asking you, what was your parents, what was your parents' support in the beginning days?
Well, it was a tough time because my both the parents were working in university and they had to travel with me and Mrunal both. So like the men-women tournaments will happen also separately. So it was two times travel. So I don't remember we going for any holidays from when I started playing chess. So it was, I think, fourth standard. So we had, I don't remember actually. It was all chess. So, but I think without parent support, it was practically not possible to play chess.
Correct.
Whatever I am here because of parents.
Correct. So what was, what you believe that that time extra edge, what your parents gave you, was it that only the moral support or the physical support? What type of support you were requiring at that time? So it was just they were with you or the type of guidance or moral support they used to provide?
See, when we were playing, I was only 8, and so that time 8 was not, it was very supposed to be very young to play chess.
Correct. Correct.
And most of the players were senior players, so they will not play with us because they will feel that, you know, I cannot lose with a very small boy kind of thing. So getting the opponents to practice was also difficult. That time the books were not easily available in India. There was no computers, no software. So only playing you can improve playing. By playing. So we were to go to Fadkesar's class and play with the boys. So my parent used to arrange a lot of tournaments for me to practice at home.
Correct.
Then second thing is I used to cry a lot when I used to lose. So I always required that support of my parents. So whenever I will lose, I'll get frustrated.
Okay.
I think without them, I won't travel normally.
So, what was the big role your coach played, like Fadkesar, or you, did you had many other coaches at different levels? So, in the beginning stage, what role you think your coach has played to develop you?
I think Fadkesar's role was very crucial in building my character, because that time we were very low on the resources. We had no books, no practice partners, no computers. So he always made sure that you should perform better in whatever facilities you have. So he always used to say that you don't have books, but you play so good that people will write books on your games. That kind of motivation he used to give us. And he also told us, you know, how to respect the opponent, how to respect the game. So while you're playing the game, opponent is your biggest enemy. But once the game is over, you are best friends. So that kind of attitude we could develop. I think then I moved to Mr. Arun Vaidya. He was an international master. So where I started learning, you know, how to prepare professionally.
Correct.
You know, like how to make the notes, how to keep the notes, how you should prepare openings. And after I became grandmaster, I worked with lot many people. Like I worked with Vladimirov, he's a grandmaster. Then I worked with Salov, then I worked with Ubilawa. So I had three, four coaches with whom, it was not a regular coaching, but I used to do camps with him that time. But the Russian culture was completely different and they had a vast experience. And you know, they had a set principles with which they should move. So I think it was very beneficial for me.
So did you got into with some international coaches also for training at the different higher level, or it was only?
Yeah, so Vladimirov was from Russia, Ubila was from Spain, Salov was also from Russia.
Okay, so all three from international.
All three international. But that was after I became national champion.
Okay, so, but before national champion, before becoming a national champion, no, you didn't got the training abroad.
Yeah.
So, Abhijit, tell me how much importance you give for mental preparation and how much it is required in chess also. And like you said, you were used to cry after you lose. And then there are so many kids you must be seeing nowadays also. Any sport you see, they lose and they bust out. So, and this mental preparation is so much important for any sport, for example. So what you used to do at your age in the beginning and then...
Well, I think if you understand, you know, like in 1995 or 96, there were only chess coaches who were there, who were helping chess players. And it was parent support. So there were no professional mental trainer coaches or fitness trainers or nutritionists who were available for the chess players as a support staff. But so whatever was, you know, learn, make mistakes, then again learn. It was like that kind of thing. But, you know, I think for all mental training, I will give that still my credit to my first coach who made us think that, you know, the resources available to you must work within that to achieve the best result.
But
of course, the point you have mentioned is very important, that now the resources are available and I think the players must use them, because it will help you in fast progression.
Correct. Because many of them...
Because, you know, it is, you play 10 days and you make one move. That's what actually matters. And then the whole tournaments get wasted.
Correct.
Like that one moment where you think about something else than chess and the whole game goes.
Correct. So how much importance do you think should be given for players at this stage who are playing? What should be your guidance to them for preparing themselves mentally, physically, technically? Technically is what they do on the court or off the court, on the court. But mentally, what should be the way of preparing themselves? So what can be your guidance on that?
You know, like the physical fitness is very crucial when you are actually playing in a tournament, because you have to play long tournaments. It is 9 days, 10 days. You are playing for 5 hours. Then also you are preparing for 4-5 hours a day. So actually it becomes 10 to 12 hours of chess every day. And it's very intense chess. And also you have to do it for 10 consecutive days. So it's always very tiring. And towards the end, I have seen many players making mistakes. And that's normally happen because you are not physically fit or you are not mentally strong.
Correct. Very well.
Because you are not able to handle that kind of pressure for so many days.
Correct.
So I think you need to keep on working. So you always understand that, you know, where you are making mistakes. And you don't treat sports psychologist as a... you know, they are different. They are there to help you achieve better. It is not that you have a problem, so you are going there.
Correct.
So I think there is a big difference.
Can you tell me, everyone can't afford a sports psychologist or something like going to that level, because nowadays even you know that sports psychologists are very expensive than coaches. So what do you think that coach or a player on itself should plan or prepare, that at least without a psychologist, what type of preparation he can do for preparing his or her mind?
So I think reading books is one thing, you know, where you can learn about how the people have stayed mentally very, very strong at such crucial moments.
Correct.
So I think reading books and doing some yoga, that helps a lot. Basically pranayama.
What do you think about observation? Like self-awareness is one thing, what you said can become to yoga and meditation. But what about observation or doing some analysis about their own game, which can build a confidence? So what do you have to say about it?
So that comes technically in our game, because for us, analyzing every game is a must. So basically, correct, after you finish your game, you come back home and you analyze your game first. So I'll tell you a story that I played one game with Barua. It was on one day. And I had made a very preliminary mistake in that game. And I understood that mistake. I rectified it. I made my analysis. So some other time, if somebody tries to repeat it, I will have a better solution for it. And next day, my opponent again repeats the same thing. So I realized that, you know, he has seen what mistake I have made. But I was prepared better. So again, I could beat him. So basically analyzing the game on that particular day is a daily practice for all the chess players.
Correct. So, Abhijit, this is also said many times, you should concentrate, improve your concentration, and all those things are guided by the coaches. But how to improve concentration? Now, this can be a very good question to you, because as a chess grandmaster, because your concentration is, if it is not there, I think you will not be able to do many of the things. So how you develop your concentration? That is my first question. And what type of preparation is done for that?
To be very frank, I have not done any special preparation for that, to develop the concentration. But I think by playing chess, you automatically develop the concentration. That's what I feel, because you are thinking about one particular thing for 4 to 5 hours.
Correct.
You know, I always give this example. Playing chess also helps you in writing exams, because when you are actually studying in schools, your lecture period is 45 minutes, but your exam period is 3 hours. So our mind is actually set up to think about one subject for 45 minutes and apply your mind only for 45 minutes.
Correct.
But your exam is for 3 hours. So I think chess teaches you to think about one particular thing for 3 hours in a consecutive way.
Correct. Mr. Peter Carlson was there, who's a five-time world champion. He was there in one of the show, and I asked him some questions related to that. So he said that you practice for almost 90% of the time, and you play matches only 10% of the time. So if you bring your entire practice as becomes a match, then that 10% also becomes a part of it. So it's about your practice sessions, how much importance you give. It can give you better results for the answers in the matches. Abhijit, about the goal planning, this is something a very important question which is required for many youngsters or those who are preparing themselves. How much importance you give for a goal planning, like daily, weekly, monthly, yearly, or do you used to do that after you became national champion, or before that only you were structured that way?
I will not say that I was, I used to have goals, but I will not say that I had a structured goals like now what we are talking about goal setting.
Correct.
So it was something like a goal setting, but not set as a goal setting. But you know, like I had a very clear ideas that, you know, what I have to do this week, which lines I need to do, what I need to prepare when I'm going for a tournament, what changes I need to make. So all these things was there, but it was not done as a typical goal setting formats.
Correct.
I also had the standard set, like what I need to achieve at the end of the year or at the end of 3 years.
Okay.
So like there are certain events where you can, basically we had 8 to 9 tournaments. So there are certain events I cannot afford to not to perform.
Correct.
There are certain tournaments where I can take chances. And there are certain big tournaments which I used to play to just boost my confidence. You know, if you win these 2-3 events, you always feel better.
So your goals used to be with some timelines, or used to set up goals or with a date or something like this, I have to achieve in the something on that particular date.
Yes,
or
it was basically a timeline, not date. Date was not practical, because you know, like you, it's a chess, it's a sport. You can't find the solutions on particular date.
Correct.
Because there may not be a solution.
Correct. It takes time. It takes time, basically.
It takes time. So, and you know, like the funniest part, most of the solution I used to get about the chess problems, that was during the sleep.
During the?
When I was sleeping.
When you are sleeping? Oh, that's very interesting.
Yeah. So it's always subconscious mind that is working, that gives you the answers to most of your questions.
So do you
used talking to about sleep, chess?
Do you used to sleep with that thought? Because of that, it used to happen, or how?
I think you are working on something for 7 to 8 hours and you don't find the solution. So your mind still keeps on working on different possibilities, and it just clicks.
Now that's a fantastic one. If you are completely involved, I guess the answers keeps on coming.
And yes, one answer keeps on coming.
One computer is before you, and one computer is you are carrying it, which is known as a supercomputer. the brain works as a supercomputer. So, Abhijit, tell me about the biggest memory of your life or lifetime memory in sport. One which you cherish.
Of course, I enjoyed playing chess for almost last 35 years. I think every game has a different memory. But most important, what I will say was the British Championship, which I won in 2003. Because, you know, chess tournaments are that way very friendly. But because of this issue with the Indians, they were not going to allow from next year. It was an 85-year-old event, and they said that they are not going to allow any foreigners to play in the British Championship. Okay. So it was open for basically all Commonwealth countries. And so it became like a last chance for the Indians to win it. And I could win the event finally. So that was something which I always cherished, to become the last Indian or foreigner to win the British Championship.
Okay, after that, they have closed the entry for the Indians to participate.
After that, only, no foreigners is allowed. Not only Indians.
Only British.
Only it is British people.
So on their soil, you have won that. Fantastic.
Yeah.
I will be definitely proud of you.
Yeah, it was in Scotland, Edinburgh.
Correct. Abhijit, what can be your guidance to parents at this moment, not only for considering chess, but overall considering sports? What will be your guidance to parents of taking care of their kid in the beginning and till the time he reaches to one level? What should be a mental approach? You have seen your parents, you have seen so many parents. So what will be your guidance?
See, you know, like I will tell you, there is a difference between education and sport. See, the education, many people succeed. In sports, correct, there will be only one national champion every year.
Correct.
And you are striving for that, but not everyone is going to become it. So, you know, like we should always look sport as a life skill, because it is giving you so many experiences that is going to help to improve your life.
Correct.
I think every child should play sport and go through that experience. That is what is most important. And of course, if he takes up sport as a profession, it's well and good. But even if it continues at a hobby, it is going to help the person for his lifetime. So I think every child at least should try 3 to 4 sports. That's what I feel, when he's young. And then maybe he can select few to try to become a professional.
So I ask this question many times. How to identify you? Are you playing the sport which you like or which you are meant for? Now, this is two different things. Like, suppose you used to like cricket, but you are, I don't know, I think you were meant for chess. So
I don't know.
It's a destiny. It has brought you there. But for many, they may be playing the sport which they like, but they are not meant for that sport. So what will be your guidance to make them understand what sport they are meant for?
Well, I think sport has to be played by liking. That is most important.
Correct.
You know, and I think it is mainly a job of parents what they are meant for. Because, you know, if you give a table tennis to a child, he is going to like it. If you give him tennis, that also is going to like it, because child loves to play.
Correct.
Correct. The sport is not important for them. I think there are so many factors, whether you can be successful or not. You know, correct, it can change from city. It will depend on which region you are. It depends on which state you are. So, you know, there are a lot of factors which will play the important role. Because you may not have coaching facilities, you may not have infrastructure, or you may not have trainers, or someplace you have all these facilities, so you can choose a particular sport. Yeah. But I think that is a role which parent will need to play according to the availability of resources. But I think for child, you just, I think you need to give him opportunity to play a few sports.
Correct. On the same line, what will be your guidance to players? So, what should be their mindset, or what type of preparation they should do?
You know, like player has to be disciplined, hardworking, because in sports, there is no shortcut.
Correct.
You have to beat your opponent. There is no other option. You have to be better than him or her.
Correct.
If you can't do that, there is nothing for you. And correct. I think every player need to have one special weapon in their armory. Otherwise, correct. They can't succeed. Like you had your that famous shot which you used to play from reverse. Behind, right? Reverse shot, yeah. So, like something has to be there, you know, which separates you from the a lot.
Correct.
So, I think that that key, I don't know, like it's for every player to identify that thing and then make sure that, you know, that becomes his super speciality. Because that area of the game, he should become so strong that he can play in that area to the world's best.
Correct.
And once he has that, then there is a good chance that he can succeed.
That becomes
because his identity. Yes, because you cannot play the sport by winning against the weak players.
Correct.
You can play the sport only if you can beat the strongest.
Correct.
Like if you beat all the weakers and if you are losing to all the strong players, then you are not going to progress.
Correct. Abhijit, one question has come to me some weeks back. I'll try to put that question before you. I met a boy who was roughly around 10, 11 years of age. And we were just chatting and he said, I don't like sports. So I said, why? Why don't you like sports? He said, I don't like when someone loses because of me and he cries. So I don't want other person to cry. That's the reason I don't want to play a sport. So what will be your answer to that?
So, you know, like my daughter is like that. So, <Okay. laughs> so there are two kind of people. That's what I say, that, you know, like the sport in which we are, our game is depending on our opponent's game. So we are actually beating the opponent. But when you play the sport like gymnastic or archery or athletics or swimming, you are actually bettering your own performance.
Correct.
So they can always choose this kind of sports where they don't have to beat their opponent. They just correct. Have to do their best.
How do you relate chess with life? Or if I'm asking you specifically, then how do you relate chess with life?
Well, I think chess teaches you planning.
Correct.
Chess gives you decision making because we make 40 decisions with available resources and with available time.
Correct.
I think that's what every person has to make. And it's not that every decision is correct or every decision is going to help you come out winning. But that decision is about making a best move in that particular position.
Correct.
You know, like just prolonging the game. So, you know, it can be different ideas. And I think third most important thing is chess teaches you to, you know, how to accept defeats gracefully.
Correct.
And learn from it and come back.
Correct. And that is what the sport teaches you at the same time.
Yes.
Abhijit, if you have to be one piece of that entire 64 pieces, which you will choose and why?
So we have 32 pieces.
32 pieces, sorry.
Yeah. So I'll be king.
You will be king? Why?
Yeah. You have to do very less work, you know.
Fantastic. Tell me one life transformation story or the biggest decision of your life. One transformation story of your life.
I'll say 1996. I played the national seniors. And till that time, you know, there were very few tournaments, as I told you. So I was a sub-junior champion. Then I was a junior champion. So I was doing very good. And this was my first try at the senior level. So there was to be a tournament where 14 players will qualify and play the senior nationals. So I got into that top 14 where you play the senior nationals. So it is a long tournament, 13 rounds. Everybody plays everyone. And so I thought, okay, I need to beat these seniors badly. And I went there and the tournament was a complete disaster. Like I finished last in the tournament. I had never finished last in any tournament. And there I realized that I need to change myself. Like the carelessness which I used to play chess, or you know, like there was certain, I used to be very fast in thinking. So all these things are not going to, only these things are not going to matter. I also need to study in much more depth and my analysis has to be practical. So the next 1 year was a lot of hard work because next year again I wanted to qualify and play this event. And that 1 year I learned so many things that it changed my approach towards chess. That's what I will say. Because it was a lot of self-learning, self-assessment, self-analysis. And I could transform myself as a better player in next 1 year. And then in 1997, I started the year by winning the National Juniors 3 times in a row. So I won that in, I think, February, March. Then in May, I played the Senior Nationals and I won that also. So like last year, I was last. Then this year, I finished first. And I became an international master there. Then I played in the Asian Juniors. I won that also. And I won that with 2 rounds earlier, like 11th round event, but I won it on the 9th round only. Like nobody could cross me after 9 rounds.
Wow.
So, and I made my Grandmaster norm. And in 98, I made my second Grandmaster norm and won the Grandmaster tournament. But I think all this was possible because I had that bad defeat in 1996.
And the decision
which helped me, you know, to introspect and perform much better. So I think you need some wake up calls sometimes.
Yes, it is very much important. I guess as you know that there are 4 levels of player, which is starting with hobby, then happy go lucky, and the 3rd level which is called dedication, and champions are born on the 4th level which is called devotion. So dedication means you give what you have, your time, your effort, energy, and everything. Devotion, when you start giving yourself, then the champions are born. So I guess that was your turning point of that, from converting dedicated player to a devoted player.
Right. Excellently put.
Fantastic. It was amazing. And my last question to you will be, what is that one X factor in you which keep you ahead of your life, ahead of your opponents in the past and now ahead in your life? What is that X factor in you?
Well, I think I will say I have a lot of different ideas.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think which is not very common. So I could do a lot of things at the same time, and at the same time, it can be different things.
Okay. For example, anyone?
So basically, when I used to play chess, and so my openings or middle game ideas had a lot of variety. So when I'm playing the game, they will not realize that which variation I'm moving in or where I'm going to get it converted to.
Unpredictable.
So doing unpredictably, but doing multiple things.
Correct.
So all because to unpredictable, you also need to have variety, because otherwise you can't shift. Because if you're a fixed player,
correct,
then it becomes a challenge.
But that requires a lot of planning at your stage in the beginning, because that will not come automatic. That must be your fundamental thing. There are a lot of variations you are creating. And then out of that variation, you are trying out a plan A, plan B, plan C, plan D at that particular moment. So if you don't work before, then I think that is not possible. But so your planning is very strong, I guess. So you consider that. So what would be that one word, if you want to put it, your X factor?
Well, I will say very tactics, I will say.
Okay. Tactically very strong?
Yeah.
Fantastic. So now here, now we start our 60-second rapid fire round, and you get 5 seconds to answer the in one word or one line. You can answer all the other rapid fire rounds. So my first question to you: what you love the most?
Food.
Okay. Something for which you can die for. Now don't tell me food.
Travel.
Your idol.
Vishwanathan.
Your biggest fear.
Not getting enough sleep.
Last thought before going to the bed.
What I'm going to do tomorrow.
Your first crush.
Meghna.
Okay. I hope she's your wife.
Yes.
You hate the most. What you hate the most?
Losing.
You miss the most?
Children.
First thought when you get up?
What I'm going to do.
Okay. One thing world does not know about you.
I think my life is an open book.
You are tactically very sound. I know you will not answer this. best advice you have ever given?
Play chess.
Okay. One thing you would like to delete from your life?
Difficult.
Okay. Best advice you have received from someone?
Well, I think it's one word, yeah?
Yeah, one word or one line? One para or one line can be put.
Invest in yourself.
Invest in yourself. Wow. And the last question will be your favorite song. And if you can hear if you can hear it from a chess grandmaster, that will be a treat for many in this entire who will be listening across India. One so, or two lines.
Why not? So, abhi na jao chhod kar ke dil abhi bhara nahi.
This is for me. This is dedicated to me.
Yes.
Fantastic. Abhijit, before we log off, what you would like to address to all which will help them to be a fighter in their life?
I think everybody should play sports. That's what I will say. Because it teaches you to accept the losses and come back from it very strongly. So enjoy life. I think COVID has taught us that fitness is more important, and anything can happen. You cannot travel. Nobody could imagine that. But I think this difficult time makes us very strong. So I think we should take this as an opportunity and improve ourselves. And I think best of luck for all of you. Keep safe.
Super. Thank you, Abhijit, for such a wonderful experience and knowledge sharing, which will definitely guide and many upcoming champions in their journey of sports. And dear viewers, I hope you must have enjoyed the show and also learned a lot from this episode. Thank you for watching and keep liking and sharing. Thank you, Abhijit. It was a wonderful
experience. Thanks, Bhushan. Thank you.
I hope
Thank you.
Enjoyed it.
Yes, it was fun. Thanks, Bhushan.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
But next time, no songs, yeah? Okay. See you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.